Good morning. We welcome to worship. We invite you to stand and sing with us This Amazing Grace.
You to sit down to watch the announcements.
Good morning, Adventure of Faith family. Welcome to Life at Adventure. Today is Communion Sunday, so if you are participating with us From home, make sure to grab some bread or crackers and juice or wine to participate with us later in service. We've got a couple of big announcements this week, but first, some little reminders. If you want to participate in Base Camp this month but weren't able to make it on Wednesday, you can grab a Base Camp box near the main entrance, which has a field guide that will walk you through all the different activities of the month. And also you can catch up on this month's teaching on our YouTube channel. If you have any questions about Base Camp, please let me know. You can email me at sam@faithadventure.com. There are quite a few events coming up. Make sure you check out the newsletter for the full schedule. A lot of them have to do with the start of Advent, which kicks off at the end of this month on November 28th. More info coming next week, but we hope you're gearing up to participate with us in this very special time of year. To kick off this Christmas season, kind of prior to Advent though, we have Operation Christmas Child. Here's Leslie with more information on that.
Good morning. I'm Leslie Fetters, and I have been the Operation Christmas Child Drop-Off Center Coordinator here at Adventure of Faith for the past 9 years. We're looking forward to another incredible year of collecting shoeboxes. This year, Collection Week at Adventure of Faith will be Sunday, November 14th through Sunday, November 21st, from 9 a.m. to noon and 4 to 7 p.m. daily. If you're interested in being a volunteer for this incredible ministry, please meet us today after service in the far side, and I'll tell you all about volunteer opportunities. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Leslie. Make sure to check out the fun Operation Christmas Child displays all over the building and our website for more information. This last big announcement is one we have been really looking forward to sharing out of both gratitude and excitement. Let me start by saying thank you to all who have generously donated to the Top to Bottom Fund. If you weren't around when we kicked off that campaign a couple years ago, the goal was to fund both a new roof and new flooring. With all of the generous donations, we were able to raise enough funds to complete the top portion of our goal. The new roof went on last year and it is working wonderfully. I can't tell you how thankful we are, especially staff who's here during the week when the heavy rains have been. We don't have to go run around the building grabbing buckets and finding the leaks because there are no more leaks. A huge thank you to Rainy Day Exteriors for replacing our roof last summer. We have also received enough funds to move forward with the first stage of our flooring project. And we've ordered the laminate flooring for the hallways, the main office, Pastor CJ's office, and part of the nursery. The laminate will be installed in January in phases. We are incredibly grateful that God has been using your generous donations to provide a sturdy roof and the start of our new flooring. The Top to Bottom Fund is still open as we look forward to completing the carpeting phases of our flooring project. For more information about where we are in this project, how to give toward its completion, and to answer any questions you may have, please visit the table we have set up today and next week during the main entrance. So you can grab a flyer with all the information and can talk to a member of our flooring team. We'll also be sending out more info in the newsletter next week. Thank you for helping us steward well the resources God has given us in this building. We look forward to years and years of it being a hub of connection for our congregation and our community. And with that, whether you are in the Worship Center, the Friendship Center, online, live with us, or later on YouTube, we are so glad that you've chosen to join us in worship today.
Please pray with me. Eternal God, in whom we live and move and have our being, whose face seems hidden from us by our sins, and whose mercy we forget in the blindness of our hearts, cleanse us from all our offenses and deliver us from proud thoughts and vain and that reverent and humble hearts we may draw near you, confessing our faults, confiding in your grace, and finding in our refuge and strength through Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Let's sing together.
Two, three, four.
answers. Far and wide, and I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide us to know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good father.
Pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, you are so good. I just pray that you will direct us and remind us of your grace, mercy, and love. I wanted to thank you, Father, for allowing us to worship together this morning. I pray over CJ's sermon that he will just feel your presence and that your words will flow through him. We love you, God. In your precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
When the disciples find themselves staring into the sky, confused about what to do after Jesus' ascension, I think we can identify with the feelings these men and women felt that day. Sometimes we still feel like we are staring at the sky, waiting for Christ's return, or wondering, where is he now? Jesus tells us that he went to prepare a place for us. What does that even mean? Where is this place? What is it like? We all probably have a picture of heaven in our minds. Where do these ideas about heaven come from? And are they even biblical? Let's find out together as we take a hard look at heaven as presented in the scriptures.
Oh, that looks off. Better, sorry. All the jokes I just told online people were really funny. Just laugh along with us. I'm not going to tell them again. All right, so this last summer, I shared this slide, this image with you that showed all the hyperlinks, the interconnecting ideas and words throughout the Bible. And if we were just to look at all these words and themes and ideas, that if you look how they connect back to the first chapter of Genesis, we would see that so much of the biblical writings are hinged on these first few paragraphs. And this is precisely where we're going to find ourselves this morning. And in fact, next week, we're going to do it again. We're going to go back to the beginning again. They keep getting connected, hyperlinked to this place. As we're trying to understand this idea of heaven, we need to go to the beginning. So if you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to please turn with them to Genesis chapter 1 again. Now, as you turn there, I want to mention that our goal today is to investigate the usage of the English word heaven in the Bible and try to grasp what the first century audience would have thought when they heard this word in their culture, in their language, without all the baggage that we have from our culture, from our language. And we're doing this because in Acts chapter 1, this is where Jesus was lifted off to. He was lifted off to heaven, remember? And when we hear the word heaven, we have many things that come to mind. Remember, angels, naked baby angels with wings, harps, and halos, right? But more than this, our understanding of heaven and life on this planet impacts how we live in the present reality as we wait for our Lord to return and bring his kingdom fully to bear on this plane of existence. So now, as I said last week, I want to make sure that we're not just doing this as an academic endeavor. You want me to switch mics? I'm still on. Hey, you can still hear me. Back to our program in process. Okay, so we were talking about this last week. This isn't just an academic endeavor. This isn't just CJ got nerdy about heaven and wants to share it with all of you. I mean, that's not all of it. It's just some of it. So our understanding here, our desire is to understand the meaning of these words written 2,000 years ago, that we might personally be transformed by them and live the way Jesus desires us to live as his people. We believe that education leads to transformation. And we're not just learning this stuff to seem like we're smart or to build an argument or to arm ourselves so we can beat up people who disagree with us. We desire to have the Spirit teach us, to weigh on us, that we might be humbled and receive transformed hearts. Our desire is to be obedient to the call and the cause of Christ. And to do that, we need to know him. And we know him through the scriptures that he's given us. Now, what's really cool is that since the beginning, the church has been a place where people can come to learn to read the scriptures and understand them in light of the context when they were written. Churches, not schools, often became the places where all people were taught to read, not just a privileged few. I was doing some research this last week on this church, on Adventure of Faith, and used to be South Kitsap Presbyterian Church, used to be South Kitsap United Presbyterian Church, that this church, on many of our founding documents, a biblical education was listed as a core value of this church. That was 43 years ago, and it's still true today. Right now, there's 4 Adventure Equip classes that are going on at 9 a.m. before this service each week. And there's one for like more mature people who've walked with Jesus a long time, one for beginners who are just starting to read the Bible, one that focuses on what it means to partner with Adventure in covenant partnership, and one that digs a little deeper into the sermon series we're in the middle of each week. And you know what's funny is that all 4 of these groups all have the same mission. They're all pursuing the same goal, just in different ways. The goal of these classes is to help equip people to be able to engage more deeply with the Bible. Education for the sake of transformation. Now, on the 28th of this month, Sam kind of hinted at Advent's kicking off in the Life at Adventure video. We're going to kick this off in Adventure Equip with doing something a little differently than we've done this first session. During Advent, the worship team is actually going to be choosing a song traditionally sung during Advent, and they're going to lead us in worship, and we're going to sing the song, and then we'll be looking at the lyrics and the scriptures behind these songs all together, kind of in the Friendship Center, actually, we're going to do this, one big class. And the hope of this session would be that we would all be drawn into deeper waters in our worship as we realize what these Christmas season songs are all about. Not just, oh, I like that song, but that it draws me to worship of the Lord. So as we sing them throughout the season, hopefully the idea would be that they're more than just songs that we like. They're more than just songs that remind us of Christmas, but they're worshipful, transformative experiences. So I hope you'll join us again. That starts on the 28th in the Friendship Center. So anyway, let's get back to Genesis. You should have had time to find it now. It's in the beginning. We're going to start in Genesis 1, verse 1. This is the first verse, and this is where the word heaven, the Hebrew word heaven, is used first. So it says in Genesis 1, verse 1, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Now, if you're doing a biblical word study on the word heaven, and as we read this verse, there's a quick question that comes to mind. What is it? Anybody else like that little S, right? Okay. Why is it plural? What is he talking about? How's this going? Okay, hold, put a pin in it, hold it. Okay, good. Ask the question. But let's look at the context of this word's usage first in this passage. Let's not just get caught up in the weeds already. We just started. So let's read on and see if we can get some of the context clues for its usage here. It goes on. It says, "The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. He called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning the first day. And then God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters. Let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so." That's a really weird translation. Stay with it. Stay with it. "And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening and there was morning the second day." Now, in the first verse we read about God creating the heavens and the earth, and as we read on, we see that this first verse is an overarching thesis statement for all that's about to occur. Okay, it's all the things. It's overarching. For the entirety of the creation narrative, that's what it's talking about. Which then demonstrates, like as the narrative keeps going, poetically, how God went about creating the world. Now, as we look at verse 8, we can clarify that the word heavens means the space between the waters down here and from the waters up there. Now remember, let's go to ancient mindset. Okay, from their perspective, the world was flat. Ancient mindset. We don't have that anymore. I'll just move on from that because apparently that's political now. Okay, the world was flat and water sprang up from the earth and then it also fell from blue skies. So they often thought there was water up there and that every once in a while it sprung a leak. You needed to call in a plumber. Okay, so that's kind of what happened. Occasionally it leaks. Now, this definition of heaven is like the space where we exist now. It's a separation of these two waters in this band. This is where we live. Below whatever that giant blue dome is that arches over everything else. It's a space that is separate from water and earth. It's precisely what's described here. It's an expanse. That's what it is. Now, if we read further, however, we see that this same word is used, but contextually it has other definitions, other meanings. So skip down to verse 14 with me. In Genesis 1:14, it says, "And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God set them into the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness." So we're back to this plural usage of the same word. And this time it's called an expanse, but it's not the expanse that we were talking about before. This is an expanse beyond the expanse. It's not where we exist, it's up there somewhere. Now if we read on, there's another expanse mentioned that is the same yet different in the expanse that we live in. So if you jump down to verse 20, just stay with me. "And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures. Let the birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens." And then if we keep reading, God blesses them and he says that they are to be fruitful and multiply upon the earth, as it says in Genesis 1:22. So the birds operate in this first heaven, this expanse that we live in, between the waters above there and down here. But they fly around navigating both the earth where they have their babies and the skies where they are move above the ground. This space where the clouds live and we live, sort of, but it's not like the birds do. It's like this, it's just weird. The birds participate in the heavens up there. There's like heavens above the heavens that we live in. So really what is given here, if we're just taking contextual clues, is there's three different definitions for heavens mentioned in these first verses, and two of them kind of sort of overlap because they don't really understand quite what's going on. First, there's this expanse between the heaven and the earth and the sky, this place where we exist. Secondly, there's a space where birds fly and clouds live. It's like up there, but it's still kind of in this expanse, but not in this expanse. It's kind of an overlapping. And then there's finally the heavens that are above the heavens, above the sky, this place where the stars and the sun and the moon reside. It's really clear. We totally understand what heaven means now in a biblical sense, right? What I love about this is that when we read the Bible in its entirety and not just focus on a few verses, we can start to like laugh because we can go, oh, we're in good company. We're in really good company. Paul himself demonstrates his lack of understanding of this strange multi-heaven view in 2 Corinthians, where he talks about himself in the third person, because if you read Paul, he's confusing anyway, but then he uses like devices like this where he says, I'm going to speak in the third person because to make it even more confusing. I don't know. This is one of my critiques of Paul in the future. He didn't make how he writes easy to understand. But he's talking about himself in the third person and about how he encountered Jesus on the Damascus Road. And he says in 2 Corinthians 12, 2, he says, I know a man in Christ, that's him, okay, he's talking about himself, who 14 years ago was caught up into the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. You can almost imagine Paul shrugging his shoulders here going, eh. If you look up like what the third heaven means, commentators will go crazy on this. There's all kinds of stuff. And you know how much evidence they have for this idea of third heaven? None. It's all conjecture. There's nothing alluded to in the Bible about this. We can make guesses, we can build some stuff up, but at the end of the day, Paul is talking about this place, a heaven beyond the heavens, a space where God dwells, a place where Jesus ascended to prepare a place for us. This probably comes from Paul's deep wrestling with his definition of heaven. Paul was a devout Jew. He would have known that this word used for heaven was primarily used three different ways. And all of them kind of overlap with one another. The word was used primarily three different ways. The first way is sky or space. So up in the sky, the birds fly in the heavens. That's one way, okay? The second is God's space. It's the space where God dwells. It's where God is. And the third is an expanse separate from earth. It's like it only is referenced separate from the earth. So there's heavens and earth. It's a separate thing. It's not earth. All that's not that isn't earth, that's heavens. So Paul is stating in 2 Corinthians that he came face to face with Jesus. Now you have to understand this is going to be really confusing to early audiences because Paul was not running around with Jesus when Jesus was on earth. What did he? He didn't, right? He encountered Jesus on Damascus Road. So he refers to himself as an apostle of Christ all the time, saying he's somebody who walked with Jesus, who has experienced the risen Jesus. And he's dumbfounded by what happened to him. He was blinded, thrown from his horse. We've read about this in Acts chapter 9. He doesn't understand how it happened. He just knows that it did actually happen. He's perplexed, as you imagine. Was this Jesus' second coming? No, because all the other stuff that he said would happen didn't happen. It seems like it happened to me. This is a very strange thing. So what he's saying is, well, I don't know how it happened. I must have been taken up somehow and to the heaven of heavens and gone to meet Jesus instead of Jesus coming down to meet him. Now we're stuck. We've read all this stuff. We looked at Paul's definition of heaven and how he's figured it all out. And we might be thinking, the Apostle Paul is much smarter than I am. And if he can't figure it out, I'm hosed. What are we going to do? We might feel pressure to just give up, shrug our shoulders, and consider it, well, it's unknowable. We'll never know. Let's just move on. But for Paul and the New Testament Christian community, heaven primarily was the place where God was. Yes, the word was used to describe the sky above the skies and whatnot, but as we discussed last week, the place where we go after we die is where Jesus is, and because he's there, it's paradise. It's not in the skies necessarily, that doesn't matter. It's not beyond space necessarily, but it's undoubtedly where God is. And in his presence, sin cannot continue to exist, so it's also paradise. So let's start working through our own working understanding of what heaven is here. First of all, it's where God is. And second of all, it's really, really good. Okay? Now, if heaven is where God is, to add another layer of complexity to this, we read in many Bible verses that talk about God, who exists through all creation. In Psalm 139, it says, "Where shall I go from your spirit, or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven," the other kind of heaven, by the way, skies, "you are there. If I made my bed in Sheol down there, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness has overcome me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you." So there's like primarily three views of how God relates to us in this world. Now, the one way is that he is in all things, which is often called pantheism. And essentially, it means that all things are God because God is in all things. And we don't believe that. Another view is deism, where God is above all things. He's not just in authority, but is in his presence. He's not here. He's kind of watching all this stuff happen. And the issue with this view is that we have a God who has come to earth, who sent his very spirit to live within us. So he is both here and somewhere else. That's that which can be very confusing, which is why we have the Judeo-Christian view, where God is above, over, and actively involved in our world. He's participating. Now, if we go back to the garden, back to where we are in Genesis, back to where we started this morning, we can look at the world that God created, where he walked in the cool of the day. I love that verse in there, where he was walking in the cool of the day. And he was alongside humanity. He had these conversations. That naked and unashamed conversation was less about clothing wearing and more about the idea that there was nothing between the relationship between man and God. And then we separated ourselves from him and his good world by choosing sin, by choosing ourselves over his design for the world, over an unfettered relationship with the God of the universe. Now, the unrepentant hearts of our first parents, Adam and Eve, who blamed everyone and anyone instead of taking responsibility for their sinfulness, could not be allowed to live in the presence of God the way they had before. Now, if we follow the narrative of Scripture, kind of from the 30,000-foot view, we can see that God, in his great mercy, will not allow humanity to live apart from him for eternity. He will not live with humanity being separate from him for eternity. So he excommunicates them from the tree of life, allowing them to live forever. This space where God and his created image bearers would live and interact in a perfect world was seemingly lost. But read on. We have to keep reading. God himself did not give up on humanity. He sought to be with them still, even as they pursued after sin and selfish desires. He pursued after them. If you flip in your Bibles, if you're in Genesis 1, flip over to Genesis 4. So this is after the fall, after the expulsion from the garden. We find Adam and Eve living out in the world, having children, trying to teach them to worship God. And one of those children becomes so insanely jealous of the other that he plots to kill his brother. Things have gone really, really bad. But I love that in this moment, in this really, really bad moment, when we expect that God is still back in the garden, that God's distances himself from humanity, we don't find God far away. God is right there with Cain. In Genesis 4, 6, and 7, it says, "The Lord said to Cain, who's processing sin, 'Why are you angry? Why is your face fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is contrary to you, but you must rule over it.'" The things that he says to Cain are amazing, are awesome, and we could totally get lost in those. What I am blown away by in this statement is where God is in proximity with Cain. He has not abandoned humanity. He is right there. He is somehow there with them, not entirely as things were in the garden, but here seeking to be with them as they once were. And if we read throughout the Hebrew scriptures, we see God desiring not just to speak with his people, but to be physically present with them. I'll deny this over and over again, but in one of my seminary classes early on, I boiled down, we were talking about the tabernacle and God's presence, very presence coming down to live in it. And as we're going through the class, I had to stop the teacher and tell her, I said, you're telling me that God moved heaven and earth to come live in a box in order to be with us, which is a really simplistic answer, and you probably have lost respect for me and my intellect right now. But that's the simple fact, but it brought me to tears. I just couldn't imagine being loved that much, that God would move everything to come be with his people in a box, in a tent, in the desert. It's incredible. So God doesn't just want to speak to his people, though. He wants to be physically present with them. He regularly speaks to people like Abraham and Moses and Isaac and the prophets. But there are also times where he begins to come into their presence physically. This happens in really strange ways in the Bible, like the burning bush. Do you remember that? Yeah. There's another one, Jacob's dream in Genesis 28. It says here that Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran and came to a certain place and stayed there that night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place to sleep. Sounds super comfortable. And he dreamed. And behold, there was this ladder, and sometimes if you translate it, stairway or pathway, set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And in you and your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you, and I will keep you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob has this really weird, strange encounter with God where things from God's space seem to be physically coming down to the earth in this place of overlapping, which we'll talk a little bit about more next week. Jacob recognizes it as a special place, that God's physical presence is somehow present. He later on, if you keep reading in the story, takes the rock that he slept on and he puts oil on it. He builds a little altar there in the promised land. For Jacob, this place becomes this hot spot for God's presence, which is a common thing that we actually see show up again and again throughout the Hebrew scriptures. There are many hot spots in the Bible where God's space and our space overlap. Often they're decorated with imagery that makes us think of the garden where the overlap was complete, the space where God's presence, heaven and earth, fully overlapped. Now, in the Old Testament, these overlapping spaces, places of God's presence, are in physical locations. They're in tabernacles, then they're in temples. And what's interesting in the New Testament, though, is Jesus changes this all up. So if you have your Bibles, flip forward with me to John chapter 1. We see Jesus change this idea of hotspots, these personal presence places of God. He flips the script on these a little bit and changes how they work now that he's in the world. So we're going to pick it up in John 1, verse 43. I hear pages flipping, so I'm trying to wait. All you digital Bible people are already there, I assume. Verse 43. It says, the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. So this guy, he's the Messiah. Verse 46, Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? I love it. Philip said to him, come and see. He's not going to try to convince him. He's just like, come and see. 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said to him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit. The little sarcasm on Jesus' part. Jesus was funny, by the way, but we don't have time for that. Nathanael said to him, how do you know me? Jesus said to him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the Messiah. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. Now, we've probably all read this passage before when we were reading the book of John. And while we're reading the Gospel of John, it's sort of just we gloss over this weird part that Jesus talks about. And it doesn't fit in the narrative because Jesus is gathering disciples. So that's what we're looking for. Jesus gathering disciples. So he's just doing it. But when we read the biblical texts, and we just merely read them as a story, as if they're one-dimensional, we miss a lot. We miss a lot. In fact, these writings are, you got to remember, they're masterful sermons. John isn't just telling what happened. He's trying to teach us. He's making huge theological statements. And it takes a lot of time to wrestle through these. Like, when Jesus said this, we should have gone, wait, I've heard that before. angels and descending and descending, that's weird. Now, in light of what we read about heaven in the Hebrew scriptures, what we see in these hot spots of God's personal presence are they're located in tabernacles and temples primarily. Now, what is the statement Jesus makes to Nathanael? He's saying that he is the place where God descends to be with his people. It's no longer this building or this tent or this hot spot. This is a huge thing. Nathanael's jaw would have dropped. We should have read this and gone, what? This changes everything. I mean, from the very least, the temple moves around now. The temple's not just in one place. Jesus went all over the place. In fact, John talks about this again. He actually already talked about it. In chapter 1, John talks about this twice. 14 verses into his gospel, he says that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and from truth. Now, if you have read the Message version of this verse, it's one of my favorite translations of this. Eugene Peterson translates this word by saying, Jesus moved into the neighborhood. But a literal translation of this word in the Greek is the Greek word for tabernacle. So many modern scholars are actually, they're making the argument that the Gospels were originally written in Hebrew. Actually, that's a common thing now, not Greek. So this word could have literally been the word Mishkan, which is the Hebrew word tabernacle. So why does this matter? It's a really cool thing. This verse literally says that Jesus tabernacled among us. Jesus became like the tabernacle. He served a purpose like it did, but he didn't stay in one place. He lived as the personal presence of God as he traveled about, doing up the undoneness of this world. Jesus went about healing the sick and casting out demons and righting what was wrong with this world. Jesus lived as a walking, talking temple, a temple that went into the world, that cleaned up the messiness of this world, and he started to clean it up. Now, John is not merely making a statement that these things occurred. He is sharing the gospel message. Think about this for a minute. Isn't this the story of our own experiences with Jesus? Doesn't he move into the neighborhood of our own hearts, into the mess that is our lives, and then begin to do up what has been undone? This is what we're saying when we say that this view of heaven as an overlapping hotspot of God's personal presence is more than just a realization of truth. It's more than just education, but a transformational reality to live in light of. See, our understanding of heaven is not merely a place we go to when we die, but it's a current reality that exists increasingly in our hearts as they are filled with Christ's Spirit, and this practical reality of us living as if that's true right now. It's being transformed right now. Now, God's chosen people used to have to go to the temple, and only the holiest people, after many sacrifices, and these, they were essentially baths, but they were ceremonial washings. They had lots of ceremonial washings, and they even tied a rope around their waist so if they died, they could drag them out of there, because they weren't even sure then. One person got to go in one time a year. And it was a really, really a huge honor to be in the Holy of Holies. Now, also when Hebrews would touch someone that was dead, who was bleeding, who was unclean, when they touched them, they became unclean. They became infected, right? Whether they did or not. If you touched somebody who was bleeding, you had to purify yourself for 7 days at least. Only the Holy of Holies. What happened when Jesus, the temple, the tabernacle, went around and touched the unclean? Who touched the dead? Who touched the woman bleeding? What happened? Did Jesus become unclean? No. The opposite happened. He made that which was unclean, clean. When Jesus was the living, walking, talking temple, touches those who are unclean, they become clean. In Jesus, the script of the whole Bible flips, and the temple is no longer a thing that people go to, but a person that goes out to the people. So Jesus was the temple, the place where people could enter into the presence of God. Throughout the New Testament, though, we see a switch there too. Jesus promises us that the Holy Spirit will come to live within the hearts of his people, of us, that they will be filled with the personal presence of God and continue the work that Jesus started. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians that our body is a temple. Now, he's not saying don't eat Twinkies. Maybe. It's probably not a good idea to eat Twinkies. But he's saying that God himself lives within you. We are walking, talking temples, bringing the presence of God to this world around us. Isn't that incredible to think about? When we get to Acts, I know someday it's going to take forever for us to get through Acts, but as we're walking through Acts, what we're going to see is the apostles filled with the Holy Spirit, becoming temples of God, walking out into the world. What happens when their shadows touch people that are unclean? What happens? They get cleaned up. They get cleaned up. They become little temples that are walking around. Now, next week, we're going to go back again to the beginning. We're going to start back at Genesis 1 again and look at the total overlap, what it was like to live in God's presence and how it was destroyed by sin. And then we're going to look how evil has infected the world but not marred it beyond recognition. We'll also look at this development of hotspots in tabernacles and in temples. And so we're going to essentially do a 30,000-foot view from Genesis to the book of Acts. So bring your speed reading glasses, and because there's going to be a lot to cover. But this theme runs through all the way through. And what's really cool as we transition to this time of communion is I want a piece of artwork that I want to share with you that my staff had bought for me that it reminds me of this idea of a hot spot. In my office, the staff bought me a piece of art that I just can't stop looking at. Actually, honestly, it causes a lot of lack of productivity in my office sometimes because I'm just sitting there staring at it. It's one of the most famous depictions of the Holy Trinity, and has been around for a really long time. It's painted by Andre Rublev in 1411, and it's a depiction of the Trinity. They're sitting at a table together. Now, remember, art always was, and it still is, a way to teach, to illuminate something for the viewer, to encourage us to feel. And Rublev simply painted this icon with the three persons of the Trinity sitting at a square table and opened the one end towards us at the front. That little line that you see at the beginning, at the front of the view, is the table open to you and to me, to the viewer. Us being invited into the table, into this perfect community of God. Now, the philosophical, theological, and practical implications of this biblical reality are huge, and what the whole book of Acts, honestly, is about. But Rublev reminds us that the Lord invites us into the work that he's doing, and it's beautiful, and I honestly just can't stop looking at it. It's a beautiful idea. Now, to be honest, it's something we do every month that is designed to remind us of the same thing. This morning, we're going to participate with fellow believers all over the world as we partake of communion together. We get to come to the table, this sacred, overlapping space where God dwells. Oftentimes in traditional meetings of communion, they'll say that this is the Lord's table. It is a reminder of both our forgiveness of sin and our access to the Father, Son, and Spirit. This is why our Savior invites those who trust him to share in the feast, which he's prepared. And as we open, I want us to go ahead and get up our little cup things, and I'm going to start us in prayer. O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe, you make for us a feast of rich food and well-aged wines. You wipe away all tears and swallow up death forever. You are our God. We rejoice that you have come to save us. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name. They sing, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. And on the first day of the week, you raised Jesus from the dead. Death could not destroy him. The tomb could not hold him. Now he lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit forever. We give thanks to you that the Lord Jesus, on the night before he died, took bread, and after giving thanks to you, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you and for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Remembering your gracious acts in Christ Jesus, we take from your creation this bread and this wine, and we joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and with your church in all the world. Send us out in the power of your Holy Spirit to show and tell this good news to all the world, that Christ our Lord is risen from the dead. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Now, if you please join me in the reciting of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now this table is open for all who profess faith in Christ Jesus and who are learning about what that means, so your children as well. If you're from different denomination but are a follower of Jesus, he welcomes you to the table, and so do we. As you walked in, you received an all-in-one communion cup thing. If you would carefully peel off the top layer, I know it's a little hard, I heard some of you already doing it, kind of working ahead. Peel the top layer, try not to pull the second one, otherwise it gets messy, just so you know. All right. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Take and eat. Now, if you peel back the second layer, that'll reveal the juice. He also said, whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never thirst. Take and drink. God of glory, we give you thanks for this feast of your goodness and grace. Send us out to share the bread of life with all who hunger for your love. Through Jesus Christ, our living Lord. Amen.
Will you stand and worship with us?
Yeah. Will you please join me in a prayer of reflection? Heavenly Father, Lord God in heaven, this morning I pray that you give us open hearts and minds to allow the words spoken today to be applied in our lives. As we attempt to move away from the world's view of heaven and ponder the biblical view of heaven, help us to turn to your word and hear what you have to say. Help us cast aside what the world wants us to think. Help us to go out this week and evaluate the words you have spoken to this congregation through Pastor CJ. Lord, let these words not fall on deaf ears, but let them light a burning desire in our hearts to seek out your biblical truths. This we ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
I invite you to join us for our last song.
Thank you.
So I know that we have youth up on stage today, and it's like, oh yeah, it's Youth Sunday, and they're doing a great job, and thank you so much for what you're doing this week, guys. And seriously, thank you, that's awesome. If you're in the back doing tech team, can you guys like raise your hands or stand up or something? There's a bunch of youth back there working too. Downstairs, every week we have youth that volunteer to teach kids about Jesus. Like, they're doing their gig too. There's people in the Welcome Center that are working right now. There's two kids that are working there. There's kids who pack worship kits every week to deliver to people who can't come to church and stuff. I'm just saying, kids are involved in the life of this church. And like I said, I've been doing a lot of research about the history of this church. That's always been the case. So when I was talking about heaven today, that we get to see glimpses of it on earth, this is what it looks like for me. This is what it looks like for me. Glimpses of heaven, spiritual fruit born that we don't deserve to see, but God lets us get a peek at. So thank you guys for leading us in worship today. I really appreciate all of you. So let me pray. Father God, I thank you for this body, these brothers and sisters in Christ. I pray that this week, Father, that as we go about bringing your world present and that day-to-day activities that we do, Father, that we wouldn't overlook the little things that we can do to bring your love, your grace, your mercy to bear on every little relationship, every little interaction that we have. Be with us, Father. Help us to live as your people, that you might multiply and do the work that you're doing in and through us, Father. Thank you. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Good job, guys.